We're looking at Luke chapter 19. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but being a short man, he could not because of the crowd. And so he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today." So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, "He's gone to be the guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save what is lost." We all know that business and advertising departments are always looking for something that will catch people's attention, that will catch their interest, their eye, will draw them to the business, to the service that they have to offer. Well, that was the case in an advertisement that showed up on the side of our plumbing company's field. This is not that truck. But on the side of the truck it said, "There is no place too deep, too dark, or too dirty for us to be." No place too deep, too dark, or too dirty for us. It was quite a statement about their service that they could offer. But I got to thinking as I encountered that phrase that it is also quite a statement about the grace of God. About the grace of God. There is no person too deep in sin, too darkly stained, or too dirty. Grace is not able. I've entitled this message this morning, "Zacchaeus, a Story of Grace," because I think the theme of grace is throughout the entirety of this story, this encounter between Jesus and this man. The description of Zacchaeus helps us to know that, well, his life was indeed deeply ingrained in sin, darkly stained and dirty. We're told that his name was Zacchaeus. His parents had high hopes and expectations for him. You know, Jewish parents oftentimes gave them their children a name that they thought would inspire or motivate them. Zacchaeus, in Hebrew, means pure or righteous. His parents thought that he would be pure or righteous. Well, he was anything but, wasn't he? He was a tax collector. He was a tax collector. He cooperated with the hated Roman oppressors. And tax collectors did not just, pull out the tax forms and ask you your income and go over and find the correct column and say, "Oh, according to the form 1090, this is what you owe." No. The tax collectors were given a minimum amount that they were expected or required to turn in to their supervisors, but anything above and beyond that that they were able to squeeze out of people was perfectly acceptable. And that's exactly what Zacchaeus and many tax collectors did. He was hated because he was Jewish, he cooperated with the Romans, and he cheated people out of their monies by charging them exorbitant taxation. Not only was he a tax collector, but he was the chief tax collector. He was a chief tax collector. Oftentimes, the person who sits at the top of a pyramid gets a portion of the income from all of the people who are beneath them, and that's exactly what the position that Zacchaeus held. He was the supervisor over a number of other tax collectors, and as such, he was entitled to a percentage of what they made. So he's garnering extra income beyond what he can make for himself, and so he is described as just strictly being wealthy. That's strictly being wealthy. Well, if we had been reading along in Luke chapter 16, chapter 17, chapter 18, leading into chapter 19, we would have discovered, we read one of those parables last week about the rich man and Lazarus, but ahead of that, we would have seen heard that Jesus cautioning, you cannot serve two masters, you cannot love both God and money. There's the rich man and Lazarus, and he was talking about the right approach to money. In chapter 17, 18, he gives another parable, and he describes how difficult it is for the rich to enter into the kingdom of heaven. And so here is a rich man who is resented for his riches. He is a man who clearly is a deep, dark, and dirty sinner who deserves to be punished by God. But as we look at this story, we find, well, actually the opposite is what is taking place. Grace abounds in this story. Grace is at the heart of Christian teaching, Christian tradition. And I'm happy to say that grace is at the heart of our Methodist tradition and theology as well. Grace is understood as God's bounty or God's favor, his free and undeserved favor. It's undeserved, it's his unmerited. It's unmerited. It's unmerited and loving action of God in human existence through the ever-present Holy Spirit. Grace is God's presence to create, heal, forgive, reconcile, and transform human hearts. Grace redeems us in Jesus Christ and is ever transforming our lives unto the reign of compassion and justice and generosity that is demonstrated by those who live in the kingdom of God. So we're going to look at this encounter and see the evidence of grace in it. Well, first of all, as we begin to look at this story, we see that Jesus takes the initiative. Luke says in verse 1, Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. Everywhere Jesus went, he's on the lookout. He's got his eyes open for people. For people in need. Are those people necessarily looking for Jesus? No. But Jesus always has his eye open to people. Jesus has a way of coming near to people when they don't expect it, when they don't anticipate it, sometimes when they're not prepared, sometimes when they don't even want Jesus to show up. He has a way of showing up. He always takes the first step. Now, Zacchaeus was aware that Jesus had come close. And so, he went out to meet him. He went out to see him. He responded to the nearness of Jesus appropriately. He climbed a tree so that he could see and get a better look and to hear better what Jesus had to say. This is an example in our Wesleyan understanding of theology of prevenient grace, God's prevenient grace. The word prevenient is derived from Latin, which means comes before. That which is prevenient is that which comes before. It's the grace of God that comes before we even begin thinking about God. We even begin longing for an experience of God. It's Jesus taking the first step and coming near to Zacchaeus. It's the Holy Spirit that works in human hearts, that worked in Zacchaeus' heart, and can work in our heart, that goes before a full understanding, a fuller understanding of who Jesus is and what God wants to do for us through Jesus. It's the Holy Spirit that convinces us of our need for Jesus. It's the Holy Spirit that convinces us and fills us with dread and fear of punishment. It's the Holy Spirit that convinces us that God is interested in our redemption, not in our condemnation. And as Jesus drew near to Zacchaeus, and as Jesus draws near to people today, God says you have a choice. You can either ignore him, reject him, hold him off at arm's length, or you can investigate. You can receive him. When Jesus comes near, we have that freedom of choice. But there will be results, there will be consequences of our decisions, good or bad. But here at the beginning of the story, it clearly displays to us Jesus has a way of always taking the first step. Salvation is God's idea. God is the actor. God takes the first step. And that is evidence, that is a demonstration of God's prevenience of going before his prevenient grace. Secondly, in this story, Jesus offers to come to Zacchaeus' house. And Zacchaeus invites him to come in. When Jesus saw that Zacchaeus was interested, he said, I've got to go to your house today. And Zacchaeus could say, my house is a wreck. My wife would be very upset if I brought someone home without giving her advance warning. Jesus, I can't do it. But oh no. He gladly welcomed him into his house. He gladly welcomed him into his house. And the people said, Jesus has gone to be with a sinner. Exactly. That's what Jesus does. He wants to come into the life, the house of sinners. He wants to come into the house of the lives of sinners to change them, to offer them his justifying grace. Justification is another name for pardon. It is the forgiveness of all of our sins. It's being accepted by God. It's entering into his household. It is not deserved. It is the free gift of God. It is ours through faith in the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It is the realignment of our lives. Wesley liked to use, John Wesley in our family, our tribe, like to use the imagery of a house to describe grace. And he said the porch is prevenient grace. When a visitor comes and steps up on your porch, they're not inside your house. They're not totally a part of your life. They may come near and knock on the door, but you don't have to open the door for them in. You have a choice. But they have taken that step, and they have come near. That's prevenient grace. Justifying grace is when we open the door and say, come on. Come on in. And Jesus brings, and he comes in. Spiritual gifts of grace. He brings reconciliation and pardon and forgiveness and justification. That was the testimony of John Wesley when on May the 24th, 1738, he opened the door of his life and said, Jesus, come on in. And he said, my heart was strangely warmed. I was changed. He said, I felt that I trusted in Christ and Christ alone for my salvation. And I was given an assurance that he had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin. That's what happens. That's what happened to Zacchaeus when he opened the door and said, Jesus, come on in to my house, to an end to my life, Jesus brought and gave him the gift of salvation, an experience of justifying grace that can be our experience as well. When Jesus comes knocking, we open our hearts, open our lives and say, come on in and live here. Finally, in this encounter with Zacchaeus, when it's all done, Zacchaeus stands up and he says, Look, Lord, I know I've been a bad character in the past, but here and now, this is what I'm going to do. He said, here and now, I will give half of everything that I have to the poor. And if I've done anybody any wrong, I will pay them back four times the amount that I've cheated them out of. Zacchaeus was not content to stay the way that he was after Jesus came into his house. His life was changed. His life was transformed. In the New Testament era, regard for the poor was highly regarded. The Apostle Paul describes in Galatians chapter 2 how he returned from one of his missionary journeys. He went back to Jerusalem and there evaluated. Let's sit down and do an evaluation of what we've just done. How effective has it been? And when all was said and done, he says, all that they asked was that we should continue to remember the poor, the very thing that I have been eager to do all along. And throughout the entirety of the book of Acts, we read about Paul taking up a collection, taking up an offering to send it back to Jerusalem to the poor. In Judaism, 20% was considered being very generous. Giving 20% of what you had is considered being very generous. Zacchaeus says, I'm going to give 50%. He's going to go well beyond the minimum. Super generous. Perhaps even to the point of almost making himself impoverished. And secondly, the law of Moses prescribed restitution. When you have cheated someone out of some physical, material object, in the law of Moses, in the book of Numbers, it says, any man or woman who wrongs another in any way and is so unfaithful to the Lord, they are guilty and must confess their sin. They must make a full restitution for the wrong that they have done and add one-fifth of the value to it and give it all to the person they have wronged. So here's this cash settlement. Penalty. One-fifth is 20%. So the value that you have cheated them out of plus 20% more. And Zacchaeus says, what? I'm going to give four times the amount that I have cheated them out. That's 400%. The point being that in both examples, Zacchaeus is demonstrating that his life has been transformed. That his experience of the justifying grace of God is such that his life has been changed. And in Wesleyan theology, that is the sanctifying grace of God. The sanctifying grace of God. Going back to that house imagery, sanctification, well, we said redeeming grace is the porch, justification is opening the door and letting Jesus come in. Sanctification is walking through the house and refreshing and cleaning up and straightening up every room. My wife worked like a little beaver yesterday. The bathroom, the kitchen, the hallway, the stove. And she was a tired little girl when she went to bed last night. You go through. Sanctification is going through the entirety of your life and devoting it all to God. And saying, what do you want me to do in this area? How do you want me to live in this area? How do you want me to live in this area? The goal for humanity is not just redemption from sin, but the total reformation of life. The transformation from the life of being a sinner and a rebel to living as a child of God, a saint in the world. Sanctification is the process by which behavior is made holy, and we are made whole in response to the act of justification. That takes two steps. It takes our part, and it takes God's part. Our part is to surrender our lives entirely, totally, perfectly to God. We say, "Your will be done." And there is God's will. It takes the action of the Holy Spirit. Paul said in Philippians chapter 2, "For it is God who works in us to will and to work, to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purposes." It's the Spirit of God that helps build that fire of desire. And it's the Holy Spirit that empowers us to take right action. Wesley knew that most people are not going to do this perfectly. He said, we're humans, we're flesh and blood. We're imperfect. We have an imperfect understanding, we have an imperfect capability. But he talked about Christian perfection, which he identified as having a perfect desire, or to be wholly intended, or to have the perfect surrender of your will, not perfect performance. And so as such, we are always going on to perfection. We are seeking to grow in sanctifying grace until, as our good Nazarene friends would say, we experience entire sanctification. Or Miss Marlene, go call me here. She'd have given me an amen right there, right? Isn't it? Zacchaeus demonstrated that a redeemed and reformed life, he demonstrated a redeemed and a reformed life by God's grace working in his heart and in his will. He experienced sanctifying grace, and we can too. At the heart of Wesleyan teaching, at the heart of Christian teaching, is the grace of God. Peter said, it's God who calls you. It's God who calls you. It's God's prevenient grace, God going ahead that calls you to come. Paul said, it is by grace that you are saved through faith. This is a gift of God. God's the one who justifies us in his grace, who looks at us and said, your sins, I forgive you. I pardon you. I forgive you. Paul said, this is God's will, that you be sanctified, that your life be transformed, that you experience the sanctifying grace of God. Now I thought, in the season of Lent, we focus on a lot of negative stuff. We say, what are you going to give up? What are you going to do to deny yourself? What are you going to do to suffer for Jesus? Self-denial. We talk about and call people to repent. The publican smote his breast and said, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. Jesus said in one of his parables. We talk about self-examination and confession and look for all of the nitpicky little things in our lives that are wrong. We talk about giving, sacrificial giving, and serving. But friends, before we complete the season of Lent, I think we also need to be assured of the wonderful message of the grace of God. After all, wasn't Jesus going to a cross? Didn't Jesus say at the end of this encounter, the Son of Man came to seek and to save? He didn't come to condemn. He didn't come to destroy. He wants to do just the opposite. No one, none, not even you, outside of God's offer of grace. It is Jesus' will that none remain lost and separated from God. His grace is available today. Zacchaeus responded to Jesus' offer. Should have turned it over a little sooner. Zacchaeus responded to Jesus' offer of grace, and his life was transformed. He experienced a new life. So I say, don't miss the peace. Don't miss the joy. Don't miss the grace of God. It is available to us when by faith we trust and receive. God wants to do a work of grace in your life today. Why not let it? Perhaps a work of prevenient grace where you suddenly say, oh my, Jesus is coming calling in a new way in my life. Why not in an experience of justifying grace where you say, you know what? I have been trying to be good in my own power and thinking that my goodness is going to earn me entry into heaven. And the answer is no. It is by His stripes, it is by His blood that we are cleansed. Why not experience God's sanctifying grace and let the Spirit of God go through the entirety of your life and reform every area? I believe if we do this, you'll be glad you did. You will be glad that you did. Grace is our message. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that you treat us and offer us to be treated much, much better than what we deserve. And that is evidence of grace. Lord, may we never presume, be presumptuous of it. But may we welcome it, may we experience it, may we